Hey everyone, welcome back to my channel. So in this video I'm gonna do cardiology questions with you guys for step 2 CK. So let's get started. Alright, so let's read the first question together. The last two lines say carotid pulses are normal bilaterally and there are no Brewis, which excludes carotid atherosclerosis. EKG shows normal sinus rhythm, no abnormalities. What is the best next step? So from the answer choices here, guys, I can see these are all investigations. So are we gonna do these or no further workup? It depends on the case. So far she has no problem with EKG nor atherosclerosis. Let's read. A 20-year-old woman comes to the office for a routine appointment physical exam. She is asymptomatic and no significant medical history, with good exercise tolerance, no medications and no illicit drugs. So far so good. Normal vitals. And however, cardiac auscultation reveals an early diastolic murmur at the left sternal border that is best heard with expiration. This is the only abnormality we see here, guys, in this 20-year-old woman. Now, I taught you guys before how to figure out murmurs, and that is through the auscultation location. Here at the left sternal border means we're talking about the aortic area. This is number one. Now, is it a regurgitation or stenosis? Is based on the timing of the murmur. This is early diastolic, and we know, guys, that the aortic valve should be closed during diastole. And so if it's insufficient or regurgitant, then that will can be considered abnormal, and that's early diastolic murmur of aortic regurgitation. So in someone who has a murmur of aortic regurgitation and no other problems or symptoms whatsoever, should we just dismiss it or should we do something? In a valvular disorder of the heart, guys, we have to do an echocardiography. So this would be the correct answer, and it will show us reversed flow throughout diastole when it should not be. The valve should be closed during diastole. All right, moving on to the next question. Let's read the last two lines. In addition to aspirin, beta blocker, statin, and ACE inhibitor, which of the following should be part of this patient's medical regimen? Looking to me, guys, like this patient has some sort of atherosclerosis, because these are the combination of drugs we give for these patients. And the answer choices, guys, dihydropyridine, calcium channel blockers, I want you to translate every mechanism written here into a drug name so you can remember it quickly. Here, guys, he means the verapamil or diltiazem calcium channel blockers that act on the heart like the beta blockers, right? Active factor 10 inhibitor, this one, guys, is an anticoagulant. Nitrates, we already know these are vasodilators. Microtubule inhibitor, here, guys, he means colchicine, which is an anti-inflammatory. P2Y12 receptor blocker is an antiplatelet called clopidogrel. And finally, PDE5 inhibitor, like sildenafil, is a vasodilator as well, just like nitrates, and they should not be taken together. So the answer choices we're already done with before we even read the question, so you wouldn't be kind of confused while answering. So let's read from the start. A 60-year-old man comes to the ER due to substernal chest discomfort over the past 3 hours. Looks to me like an acute coronary syndrome. He has had no shortness of breath, lightheadedness, or palpitations, but has an episode of profuse sweating when discomfort started. Like a typical attack of acute coronary syndrome. He has a history of type 2 diabetes. EKG shows normal sinus with ST segment depression in leads V4 to V6. ST segment depression means that this is a non-STEMI, non-ST elevation MI or angina. We don't know yet. However, we actually know because no anginal attack remains for 3 hours. This is probably a myocardial infarction, and it will be confirmed by the troponin level. As you can see here, it's elevated, and 6 hours later, it's on the rise. All right, now we have taken him to the cardiac cath, and coronary angiogram shows near total occlusion of the left circumflex. And this is consistent with the EKG findings in leads V4 to V6 in the lateral part of the heart. Now, we treated him with an everolimus eluting stent, and the rest of the coronary vessels do not need treatment. So, what other drug does he need, guys, in addition to aspirin as an antiplatelet, right? Beta blocker for his hypertension, statin for the hyperlipidemia, ACE inhibitor for cardiac remodeling. All this is fine. But because, guys, we have installed here a stent, it's not sufficient to just give one type of antiplatelet. Aspirin only acts on one mechanism of platelets, which is COX-1 inhibition of the arachidonic acid pathway, so that the platelets do not produce thromboxane A2, important in platelet aggregation. However, guidelines say that we need an additional antiplatelet if this person is on a stent for at least a year, and in this case we need something to also block the action of ADP, which is another promoter of platelet aggregation. And this other antiplatelet, guys, like clopidogrel or prasugrel or ticagrelor, acts to block the P2Y12 receptor on the platelets, and this was the correct answer. All right, by blocking this receptor and blocking the COX-1, this way we are inhibiting platelet aggregation in two ways, right? So that a thrombus does not form on top of the stent. All right, guys, next question. Let's read the last two lines. So, chest x-ray reveals bilateral lung infiltrates involving primarily the middle lung fields. Which of the following is the most likely cause of this patient's symptoms? From the answer choices here, guys, advanced heart failure. Do you think heart failure will cause lung infiltrates in the middle fields, or would pulmonary edema due to heart failure be mainly bacillar in the base rather than the middle fields? This is just for starters, guys. Before we read the question, think about it. All right, B, antiarrhythmic toxicity, we're still gonna see. C, diuretic toxicity. I don't think any diuretic would be responsible for pulmonary edema to begin with, or any lung issue. But let's see, tricuspid insufficiency or viral pneumonia. Let's see about that. So a 65-year-old man with known ischemic cardiomyopathy comes to the office due to 2 weeks of progressive shortness of breath and non-productive cough. A typical person would think this is probably progression to heart failure. 1 week ago, he was instructed to increase his furosemide dose. So this is the loop diuretic that he was asked to increase its dose. But trust me, guys, it will not cause pulmonary edema. It's used to treat pulmonary edema. And so we should be excluding C. Now, it did not seem to help. He has had no chest pain or orthopnea. He takes all medications directed. Patient had an MI 5 years ago and has severe systolic dysfunction with an ejection fraction of 20%. This is markedly reduced. Normally, it should be over 55% at least. He has an automatic implantable cardiac defibrillator, and 6 months ago, he was hospitalized with recurrent shocks from this defibrillator due to ventricular tachycardia. So this person also has an arrhythmia. In addition to his ischemic cardiomyopathy, he has arrhythmia and therefore has to be treated for this arrhythmia. What do you think, guys, is the best treatment for ventricular tachycardia? We usually treat this with amiodarone. All right, so this question is tricky, right? He's currently still taking, so he has been started on this antiarrhythmic 6 months ago. Let's see. He is afebrile, normal vitals, mucous membranes, normal everything. Bilateral inspiratory crackles are heard on lung auscultation. No murmurs, no edema. Do you think, guys, that advanced heart failure that would lead to the extent of pulmonary edema will not cause peripheral edema? This is highly unlikely. So this is number one. If heart failure is not causing peripheral edema, it's unlikely to cause pulmonary edema if it's that significant. Ischemic cardiomyopathy here is reaching 20%. Number two, the chest x-ray, guys, shows infiltrates in the middle fields rather than the basilar lung fields. This is against the diagnosis of heart failure, so we're going to exclude this as well. So the only thing apparent here, guys, since he is afebrile, it doesn't seem to have any infections. We're gonna exclude viral pneumonia as well, and there is no heart murmurs, and this excludes valvular disorders, so we're excluding tricuspid insufficiency. So even if you don't know, guys, that the drug he's taking, amiodarone, is associated with pulmonary toxicity, you can essentially figure it out by exclusion. All right, guys, now amiodarone is well known to cause chronic interstitial pneumonitis, pulmonary fibrosis, all this stuff that is responsible for his pulmonary symptoms. All right, guys, so I hope this helped. Let me know what you think.